What you will learn. We'll talk about how to create and maintain a comprehensive emergency action plan, how to complete a vulnerability analysis, how to write an employee emergency plan, how to write fire prevention plans, how to use employee alarm systems. We'll give you a summary and a quiz.
Yoo-hoo!
OSHA talks about emergency action plans under 1910.119, hazardous materials, process safety management. It's also covered under .120, hazardous waste operations, and .157, fire protection. .272 covers special industries in the grain handling. .164 covers fire protection. .151050 covers toxic and hazardous substances. And .160 covers fixed extinguishing systems. .1047 covers toxic and hazardous substances.
Yoo-hoo!
OSHA's Portable Fire Extinguishing Standard calls for an emergency action plan and fire prevention plan is required when the employer requires a total evacuation of the workplace regardless if extinguishers are provided, but not intended for employee use or not.
Yoo-hoo!
OSHA's Portable Fire Extinguisher Standard states, the employer shall provide fire extinguishers and designate certain employees to use them, and all other employees must evacuate. What is an emergency? An emergency is an unplanned event that can cause death or significant injury to employees, customers, or the public. An emergency can shut down your business or organization, disrupt operations, cause physical or environmental damage, and/or threaten the facility's financial standing or public image.
Yoo-hoo!
What workplace emergencies have you personally witnessed or known details about first-hand observers? What happened? How many people were affected? What is emergency management?
No!
Well, emergency management is a comprehensive system set up to address and handle natural and man-made hazards. Emergency management is the process of preventing, preparing for, responding to, and recovering from an emergency. In an ideal world, we would practice the first two steps, prevention and preparedness, and go no further. However, we need to consider also response and recovery programs. Emergency escape procedures and escape route assignments. Procedures to be followed by employees who remain to operate critical plant operations before they evacuate. Procedures to account for all employees after an emergency evacuation has been completed. Those are part of the six elements of an emergency action plan. Six elements of a rescue plan include rescue and medical duties for those employees who are to perform them, the preferred means of reporting fires and other emergencies, the names and regular job titles of persons or departments who can be contacted for further information and explanation of plan duties. The five elements of a fire prevention plan include a list of all major fire hazards, including the proper handling and storage, potential ignition sources and their control, type of fire protection, and equipment necessary. Procedures to control accumulations of flammable and combustible waste materials. Procedures for regular maintenance of safeguards on heat-producing equipment. Names or job titles of employees responsible for maintaining the equipment. Names or job titles of those responsible for control of fuel source hazards. Employers must designate employees to assist in the safe emergency evacuation of other employees. These designated employees must receive training in emergency evacuation procedures. Here's a good discussion question for you. What should this training address? Individual roles and responsibilities, information about threats and hazards, protective actions that need to be taken, notification and communication procedures, warning signals and procedures, means for locating family members, emergency response procedures, evacuation, shelter, and accountability procedures. Don't forget about the location and use of emergency equipment and emergency shutdown procedures to go to your employees. Emergency action training can take many forms. Each employee must receive a review of an emergency action plan and fire prevention plan. What methods do you like for your business? Each employee must be informed of, number one, the fire hazards of their work area, the criteria for self-protection as outlined in the fire prevention plan. At minimum, the employee review must be accomplished A, when either the plan or the employee's job is new, when the employee's responsibility under the plan change, or when the plan itself changes. Group discussion. Should visitors to your facility receive some sort of review of the plan? Warning systems and emergency alarms. Describe to the workers the alarm system used in employee orientation and supervisor review. It can be a paging system, audible tones, detectors, word of mouth, visual systems, tactile systems, vibration, air fans, email, etc. Alarms must be capable of being perceived alone above ambient noise or light levels by all employees affected. Tactile devices, vibration, or forced air may be used to alert those who otherwise would not recognize an audible or visual alarm. The alarm must be distinctive and recognizable as a signal to evacuate the work area or to perform actions designated under your employee emergency action plan. Where a communication system also serves as an alarm system, all emergency messages shall have a higher priority than non-emergency messages. How about where is your alarm system? How is your alarm system activated and transmitted? Test alarm systems monthly. One documented case OSHA noted, the company conducted its first test of sophisticated alarm system 21 years after the system was installed. It got rather than alarm bells, it played Christmas music. Developing your emergency action plan points of action. They should include analyzing capabilities, vulnerability analysis, direction and control, communications, emergency evacuation procedures, and a plan evaluation. What have or are you doing to prevent or mitigate an emergency at your workplace? What should you also consider and or develop for your workplace to prevent or mitigate an emergency? Remember, prevention through planning. Prevention programs mitigate through hazard identification and control. Preventative actions can also include promoting sound land use planning, relocating or elevating structures out of floodplains, securing shelves and water heaters to nearby walls. Installing hurricane straps to secure structures, developing and enforcing effective building codes, engineering roads, bridges to withstand earthquakes, using fire retardant materials in new construction, developing and implementing a plan in your business or community to reduce susceptibility to hazards prone to the area. An emergency action plan can be very effective in preparing and developing. Of course, an emergency action planning team can, in addition to the team you already may have established. Who should be on the team? How about the safety committee?
Yoo-hoo!
Analyze capabilities and hazards of your situation. Review internal plans and policies. What documents will you look for? Keeping your plan relevant means looking at evacuation plans, fire protection plans, safety and health plans, environmental policies, security procedures, insurance programs, plant closing policies, examining your employee manual or a hazardous materials plan. These are all plans that need to be updated regularly to keep them relevant. A risk management plan, mutual aid agreements, finance and purchasing procedures, capital improvement plans are also plans that need to be updated to keep them relevant yearly. What documents will you need in the event of emergency occurring at your location? Ask this question before it happens. Emergency call lists, building and site maps that indicate utility shutoffs, gas main valves and gas lines, electrical cutoffs, electrical substations, storm drains, sewer lines, water hydrants, water main valves and water lines, as well as the location of each building floor plans. Again, documents you're going to need in the event you're in an emergency. Documents you will need in event of emergency include alarms and annunciators, fire extinguishers and fire suppression systems, exits and stairways, designated escape routes, restricted areas, hazardous materials, etc. Here's a partial listing of outside groups you may want to meet with. The fire department, police department, community emergency management office, hospitals and the Red Cross, the National Weather Service, the Public Works Department, the telephone company, electric utilities. Identify codes and regulations that affect your business. Where will you look for these codes and regulations? Well, how about OSHA, your emergency management office? Environmental regulations with the EPA or your state? Seismic safety codes, transportation regulations, the Uniform Building Code, Life Safety Code, zoning regulations, corporate policies, public agency policies, the law libraries, and the internet. Identify critical products, services, and operations. What area will you review? Areas that you should review are products and/or services provided by suppliers, lifeline services like electricity, water, sewer, gas, telecommunication, and transportation. Identify internal resources and capabilities. What resources and capabilities will you need in the event of an emergency? Personnel like hazardous materials response teams, emergency medical services, and an evacuation team. Identifying internal resources and capabilities includes fire protection and suppression equipment, communications equipment, warning systems, emergency power equipment, facilities like emergency briefing areas, organizational capabilities including an evacuation plan, and employee support system. Identifying external resources that may be needed in the event of an emergency includes community emergency workers like paramedics, police, firefighters, where you will focus on their response, where their need is the greatest, or where they may be victims themselves. What ones might you need? Emergency Management Division, Fire Department, Emergency Medical Services, the hospital, local and state police, community service organizations, utilities, supplier of emergency equipment, and your insurance carrier. What else must be addressed when considering outside resources? Plan ahead. Make arrangements with vendors when developing your plan. Some of them may require written agreements for rapid response times. An important part of your emergency action plan will be doing a vulnerability analysis of your facility. This process will involve assigning probabilities and estimating the impact, as well as assessing resources and using a numerical system. See the example below. Types of emergency: historical or geographic, technological, practices and conditions, physical and regulatory. Emergencies which you may seek to plan for include analyzing each potential emergency from beginning to end, considering what could happen as a result of prohibited access to your facility, loss of electrical power, communication lines being down, a ruptured gas main or water damage, as well as structural damage. You need to consider what could happen as a result of a air or water contamination, an explosion occurring, a building collapse, trapped persons from a number of sources, a chemical release. Estimate the probability of each incident. In the probability column, rate the likelihood of each emergency's occurrence. Of course, it's a subjective consideration, but it can be useful nonetheless. Use a simple scale of 1 to 5, with 1 being the lowest probability, to 5 being the highest. Assess the impact of a human on potential humans. Analyze the potential human impact of each emergency and the possibility of death or injury occurring. Assign a rating in the human impact column of the chart. Use a 1 to 5 scale, with 1 being the lowest and 5 being the highest. Assess the potential property impact. Considering the potential property for losses and damage. Again, assign a rating in the property damage column, 1 being the lowest and 5 being the highest. Consider the cost to replace, the cost to set up temporary replacement, and the cost to repair. Assess the potential business impact. Assign a rating to the business impact column, again using 1 as the 5 as the lowest and 5 as the highest impact. Consider business interruption, employees unable to report to work, or customers unable to reach your site. A company in violation of its contract, imposition of fees or penalties and legal costs, an interruption of supplies, an interruption of product distribution. What will be your internal and external resources? Assess them. Can we respond? Will external resources be able to respond as quickly as we need them? If the answer is no, then you may need to develop additional emergency procedures. Add training, acquire additional equipment, establish mutual aid agreements, or contract with specialized services. Okay, now add up all the columns and total the scores for each emergency. The lower the score, the better. While this is subjective, the comparisons will help determine planning and resource priorities. We'll be right back. When developing your plan, include the direction and control procedures necessary, as well as communications that will be needed, emergency evacuation procedures, and coordination with outside agencies if necessary, as well as building in a mechanism to evaluate the plan for its relevance. The two steps of emergency management that you want to focus on are prevention and preparation. The emergency action team that you will include should be listed in your plan. Based on emergencies you have listed above, what prevention methods and strategies will your employer establish and implement? Based on emergencies that you have listed, what prevention methods and strategies will be established and implemented? A primary function in preparing your emergency action plan is analyzing your capabilities and hazards. Many steps are involved in this analysis, include reviewing internal plans, policies, and supporting documents, and meeting with outside groups. Included in developing a plan will be identifying codes and regulations, identifying critical products, services, and operations, internal resources and capabilities, external resources, and conducting an insurance review.
Yoo-hoo!
Doing a vulnerability assessment as an effective tool to gain a better understanding of where you are in terms of resources versus the risk that you will involve. Where do you begin in developing a plan? Well, have you established a direction and control or chain of command in the case of an emergency? If not, can we establish an emergency operating center? If yes, where? At minimum, OSHA requires the following components to be included in your emergency action plan: emergency escape procedures and escape route assignments. Procedures to be followed by employees who remain to operate critical plant operations before they evacuate. Procedures to account for all employees after an emergency evacuation has been completed. Rescue and medical duties for those employees who are to perform them. The preferred means of reporting fires and other emergencies. The names and regular job titles of persons or departments who can be contacted for further information or explanation of planned duties. Developing a plan will include asking questions such as, do we have effective emergency communications? Do we have an effective warning and/or alarm system? If not, what should we have? Do we have an emergency evacuation plan established? If not, where do we begin? One hint is develop a checklist coordinated with outside agencies, etc. Training for all employees will address individual roles and responsibilities, information about threats, hazards, and protective actions. Training will also include individual notification and warning and communication procedures, the means for locating family members during the emergency, emergency response procedures, evacuation, shelter, and accountability procedures. Additional training issues will be the location and use of emergency equipment, emergency shutdown procedures, practice drills at least once a year, so that employees can ask the question, what is my role? Where should I go?